as we're setting up the chairs, I'd like to bring up the speakers for this next session. We'll continue this discussion that you've set up so nicely. Katie Butler, if she can come up, she's a marketing director at GE Measurements and Control. Atif Rafiq, who's senior vice president and global digital officer at McDonald's. And Scott Kirstner from the Boston Globe, who will be leading the discussion. If you could all come on up, thank you very much. Nice to see you all. And sort of, you know, big takeaway I got from your presentation, Donovan, is that we want to use all these automation tools to automate our communications with our customers, but our customers are humans and they want to be communicated to as humans on a one-to-one basis. So how do you square that circle? Scott?
All right, thank you, Eric. Human-to-human communications, that's what we're here to talk about. We have some actual humans in the audience, I believe. Is that true? Yes? Can you just, maybe by show of hands, like entrepreneurs who are in the audience, bigger company people, like maybe, you know, 100 plus person company people, and then like what's the remainder of this audience? Ad agency, marketing, technology, like someone who didn't raise their hand, what are you? Just a technology person, like where at what sort of company? All right, a not-for-profit systems engineering. And how about you? We're doing some human-to-human communications. Oh, all right, they work at the same company, who knew? All right, so the clock has started ticking on us for this session. We are like under tremendous stress. This is gonna be the NASCAR pit stop of panel discussions about marketing technologies. We have three really great speakers. So let me just dive right in and anyone feel free, you know, this is a jump ball, but what, and Donovan, maybe we'll give you the last crack at this question. But what's an example of an important new consumer behavior or B2B behavior in your case, Katie, that people are going to be talking about as we head into 2016? Like, what do you see as emergent in the marketing space?
Sure. So one example is connected devices. So finding a way to leverage data and devices to create products, services, or experiences. And we're seeing that across the oil and gas industry, the power gen space, as well as aerospace. So very industrial market segments.
And if we're trying to talk to those markets and get their attention, what works from your perspective? I mean, are they paying attention to email? Are they still reading print? Like, what's the way to get their attention?
Sure, so a couple things. One, we're seeing an increased need for improved user design and experience. Mm-hmm. Two, we're seeing real-time customer service needed. And I think thirdly, a key item is around value-based decision-making mm-hmm. across their assets.
All right, cool. Atif, what do you think in emergent consumer behaviors?
Well, one we talk a lot about in our space, and I think all retailers need to be talking about, is what I call the Uberification of everything. Mm-hmm. And what I mean by that is really transparency and the fact that consumers are now accustomed to and actually expecting a level of transparency. So to give you a quick example, if you drive on a highway in Chicago, you will see a billboard for a hospital that is showing the real time, the wait times for its ER rooms. Mm-hmm. So hopefully it's less and not more, and you won't need to use it. But the point is that people now expect that when the space between when they ask for something and when that need is met, they know exactly what's going on in the middle. Mm-hmm. And that's a huge expectation, and everyone who services customers, whether it be B2B or consumer, needs to think a lot about that.
All right, so you guys are going to do billboards with like wait time at the nearest McDonald's drive-through?
Well, I do think that from the point at which your belly says, I'm hungry, uh-huh. and you choose, hopefully, McDonald's, that we should let you know how long, once we have taken the ball and we've gotten the process underway of getting that order to the kitchen, mm-hmm. we've got to let you know how it's going.
Yeah.
And the real reason why I think this is not just a fad is because making time work for people is actually a really great thing. And it's why you actually wait longer for Uber than you do, in some cases, standing outside on the city street when it's very busy for a taxi. And it's because that overhead on your brain is a lot lower, mm-hmm. and you know it's coming, so you can make use of the time.
I want to pivot the question a little bit to you, Donovan, because I think one of the phrases that I remember Uber talking about really early on was like the mobile phone at becoming kind of a remote control. Maybe it was Jason Calacanis who sort of used this term, like a remote control for your life. So you're tracking a lot of what's happening between consumers and this mobile device. Are there ways, I mean, I sort of feel like, just in my anecdotal experience, I often notice, like, I've downloaded an app and it's starting to send me notifications every 3 hours that I don't care about. Are there ways that you see sort of people screwing up with that mobile marketing channel, with notifications, with text messaging as marketing?
I think the biggest area where that's happened is in local deals. So mm-hmm. there's been overabundance of participation in that category space. People are inundated with irrelevant offers, mm-hmm. you know, and merchants themselves are overwhelmed by how to configure deals and offers that are going to be actually profitable to them,
yeah.
and not just going to have people who have become very expert at exploiting promotional offers in many different ways and abusing them to a large degree. So you've got
yeah.
that problem, and I think people in general want simplification. Mm-hmm. You know, and what if you think about all of the profound disruptors and new contenders that are in the marketplace, the commonality is they taking out cost or burden or headaches or hassles, mm-hmm. and they're replacing it with simpler, easier, faster, better kinds of experiences. Mobile device is the preferred interface for people today, and there's no
yeah.
question about what's happening with the millennials, and we can get into that a little later, but there's some other shifts and changes relative to that as well.
Mm-hmm. Atif, I want to go back to you because we were talking backstage a little bit about social, and give us an example of just something you guys have been doing, you know, to reach millennials or just to experiment with new social channels for marketing.
Yeah, I mean, we're very aggressive. Naturally, we have with the new ad platforms and trying to understand what works, what's not going to work. So a recent example would be Snapchat. And Snapchat came to us and said, can we do something creative? So what we did was we created filters that are really fun and engaging, and they're geo-based filters. So the way they work is if you show up at McDonald's, these filters are unlocked. And what can you do? Well, you can have a basket of our iconic fries poured over your head, and that just unleashes a whole bunch of creativity with people who like to kind of do something with that. And so it's not something you can do every single day, because to your point, I think there's a certain level of scarcity around people's attention, so mm-hmm. we run it every few months. But whenever we do that, you know, we've found millions of people actually creating content, and that's why it's interesting, because it's a way to get foot traffic, but also allows the user to express themselves and around their love of your brand or their affinity for your brand.
Mm-hmm. Katie, I want to ask you about the data topic that Donovan brought up. I mean, you can't go to any conference. You know, you could have the big data buzzword bingo card and see, you know, all the different terminology around big data, you know, the data tsunami that gets mentioned at most conferences. GE is known as a super data-oriented company. So, like, are there examples you could give us where you're using data, mining data to kind of market in new ways, particularly these B2B customers that your group serves?
Sure. So, specifically, the way that we're using data in our business is to deliver products and services for specific customer segments, where we're now delivering results for a customer versus delivering a product. So mm-hmm. leveraging the data, acknowledging that in some of these industries we serve, like oil and gas and power gen and aerospace, the workforce is aging, and now we need to be able to help the customers provide the same sort of service, but without maybe the aging expertise. So leveraging the data to provide the customer with results.
Mm-hmm. And I'm guessing, you know, when I hear you and others at GE talking about connected devices and sort of the data stream that you get about, you know, the need for maintenance or, you know, what all the different add-ons and features of this particular device are that potentially could be upgraded, like, do you see that as a new, you know, as kind of opening up a new channel for Absolutely. Marketing, you know, knowing that, you know, there's a turbine somewhere that is performing at, you know, 78% efficiency and something the customer could do could get it higher?
Yep. To be able to predictively analyze their assets and improve, you know, uptime, efficiency, production of the customer's various assets. So mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Cool. So Atif, you mentioned Snapchat. Is there anything else, you know, I guess it's like, what else are the kids using nowadays? But, you know, are there other channels, other platforms you guys are tracking as like, hey, this is, you know, this is potentially the next big channel, not necessarily for marketers, but just for, you know, for human-to-human communications?
Well, I think one thing everybody needs to think about are owned channels. And the reason I think that's very, very important actually is because it's getting, there's a lot of noise out there. So with the paid channels, you know, it's not only the expense, but it's a question of how is your story coming across and is it really landing? And if you're a company like McDonald's and you have people come into your restaurant or your retail location, it's a little bit easier because you can forge a direct relationship with the customer. And we have some, you know, really interesting plans there. We've got 69 million customers a day, which is pretty, you know, high scale. It's hundreds of millions of people in any given year, and when they come into McDonald's today, it's as if they dropped down from Mars and walked in for the first time, and we treat them the exact same way. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't learn from what they did before with us, and that's not a good thing. But that point aside, whether you are a retailer, and obviously it's a little more challenging as a manufacturer when you're sitting on someone's shelf, but developing those own channels, I think, is really critically important. It's the only way to actually really tell your story. And obviously, there's probably some efficiency there as well in terms of driving the result.
Let me pick up on what you just said. We just completed a study which really generated a lot of interest, which is making the workplace a brand-defining space. And what's happening today with, obviously, the pervasive use of devices and people's desire to want to record and celebrate moments and to share that content, we're seeing, you know, employers, smart employers starting to think, oh, we don't want to just push out company publications and newsletters and have a website, but we want to invite our employees to actually define and shape perceptions of the brand using their own social networks, using their own channels of interaction engagement. And, you know, platforms that have come into the marketplace that support the ability for you to, in effect, do organizational branding and also do, in many cases, large organizations that have dealer networks or franchisees or company-owned and operated stores or branch offices. You know, how does management get more visibility into that point of interaction with a customer to celebrate those moments? When I was a young kid back in the UK, I had a campaign that I was supposed to promote, which was called We Try Harder, and it was Avis Rent-A-Car. And Avis Rent-A-Car was not number one, Hertz was number one, but We Try Harder was a really strong, compelling statement. And the question was, how can we get everybody in that organization unified and aligned behind that promise and actually show that they're delivering on it? And today, with the technology that's out there and the fact that everybody's connected real time, you can also solve problems faster, you could celebrate moments more greater, you can launch products more effectively, and those are the things that I think are changing.
One quick thing on launching products, if I were really far out there on a limb, I would mention something like Product Hunt. Is anyone using Product Hunt? I mean, it's a really interesting way to look at launching a product and creating such a strong, you know, viral fan base at the beginning where, it sort of lands on the scene in the right way. And,
I would mention like Kickstarter, I feel like, is a marketing technology for a lot of startups, right? Because you're sort of trying to connect with customers who are willing to open their wallets, and you know, sometimes the feedback you get is like, yeah, I really want that, and sometimes it's not, missed the mark.
I completely agree, and it's not just about putting up a Kickstarter page. There's a lot of marketing that actually happens behind the scenes in terms of saying, who do I find on Twitter that's actually interested in this and push? So there's a lot going on there. It's sort of a new frontier.
So in our waning moments here of this NASCAR pit stop panel. What's an example? I mean, we've been talking mostly about outward-facing marketing technologies as opposed to maybe back-end, back-office stuff people are using to manage a marketing campaign or manage, you know, maybe employees and kind of what they're doing on social media and all kinds of analytics technology. So could be outward-looking, could be an inward-looking technology. Give us a take on, like, something that's either really high potential or maybe really overhyped, or maybe something that's like tried and true. Like, I'm still surprised at how like a really well-written email can perform as a marketing technology.
So we use two platforms that are more established but work well for us given our customer base. And we, our channel to market is both through direct sales personnel as well as indirect channel partners. So we use Marketo and Structured Web. Mm-hmm. And Structured Web is similar to the Marketo platform, but for us to be able to manage our platform, our revenue marketing campaigns with our channel partners. So where we provide the content and all of the assets, and it's a platform to help them execute and reach our end customer base. And those two work really well for us to be able to track from click or engagement to a closed won opportunity.
I would highlight merchandising technologies. So when you come into a retail environment, how do you let people know what's interesting, what they might try and discover? So of course we have menu boards, and increasingly those are digital at a McDonald's. Mm-hmm. And digital is more powerful, of course, because you have content management, and so you can highlight by day part, you can target a limited time offer, and that's actually drives significant ROI for us. If I take that forward and I think about beacons, right? And beacons haven't come up, or maybe they have, I'm surprised. Beacons are useful for a lot of different things, you know, around location awareness, but I think it's also a merchandising technology because it's an individual channel to a customer. So if they have the phone and you have the beacon and you know enough, then you can send something much more targeted. So to me, it's like a menu board, mm-hmm. saying, okay, here's the new burger we launched this month only, but it's actually speaking to an individual. So I think while they are, you know, generally in that overhype mode, I think they have some real substance.
See, I think you guys invented the original old school beacon at McDonald's to get families with kids into your stores, and that was the Happy Meal toy. Like, it just still has amazing gravitational pull of you're in a car with a child and there's a McDonald's somewhere on the horizon.
I know this is bleeding into 3D printing pretty quickly.
Yeah, that's going to be the next panel.
Yeah, we'll do that next year. Yeah.
I think a big area of focus is localization. For those of you who are out there, we've got globalized markets but localized needs and requirements. And companies today have got to look at how they can not only support their channels with localized content creation, but if you just think about banks today in North America with the multicultural society have to localize. They have to localize in communities that are retired, into college towns, into Hispanic markets, Asian markets, Black America, African markets. It doesn't matter. You've got pockets where your outlets, and I'm sure McDonald's does the same thing. You've got to adapt and adjust to that. Mm-hmm. You've also got to adapt and adjust your user interface. So if you're building complex machines and technologies, you know, taking that into Africa without having a clear understanding of the operational dynamics in those markets, the technicians are not as educated, they're not fluent lingually. There's a whole variety of issues. So localization and how you address that, not just from the standpoint of language, but more from the standpoint of culture, cross-cultural.
Yeah, even micro-geographies, Boston customers are different from Cambridge customers, Somerville customers, that's a whole other thing.
Right, and heaven forbid that you would feature a Kenyan in a Nigerian ad, it'd be terrible. So those are the things you have to be careful about.
Okay. Cool.
Nuances.
All right, Katie, Atif, Donovan, thanks so much for a really great session.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.